The Holy Gospel for the first Sunday in Lent is recorded for us in St. Mark, the first chapter, beginning with the 9th verse. In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." And the Spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness. He was in the wilderness 40 days, tempted by Satan, and he was with the wild beasts, and the angels waited on him. Now after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." This is the gospel of our Lord. Children of God, grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father, and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The text for the first Sunday in Lent is always Jesus' temptation in the wilderness, set between his baptism and the beginning of his public ministry. Matthew and Luke give us some details about the temptation. They tell us that after 40 days, Jesus was famished, and Satan came and said, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." Jesus responded, "Man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." Satan took him on the pinnacle of the temple. "Throw yourself down, for it is written, he will give his holy angels charge of you. They will bear you up lest you dash your foot against the stone." And then to a high mountain, showing him all the kingdoms of the world. "All of this and its glory will be yours if you would bow down and worship me." Jesus said, "It is written, you shall not test the Lord your God." Matthew and Luke give us this detail. But in Mark's gospel, we get two verses for the temptation. "And the Spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness. He was in the wilderness 40 days, tempted by Satan, and he was with the wild beasts, and the angels waited on him." In these two verses, we glimpse the awesome power of Jesus in the wilderness with the wild beasts. Do you think he was afraid? Or because he was God, he had nothing to fear, right? I do not believe he was afraid of the beasts, but not because he was God incarnate, but rather because he was what God intended humanity to be. Go back to Genesis 1 and 2, the story of creation. We learn there that God intended us to be in perfect harmony with himself, at peace within ourselves, in harmony with one another, and in harmony with nature. There were no wild beasts, nor anything to fear. This Jesus who stilled a storm, this Jesus who at the beginning of Holy Week rode into Jerusalem on a donkey that had never been ridden before. What will a donkey do that's ever been ridden and you try to ride it? Try to throw you off, of course, but it did not do that because there was perfect harmony between Jesus and the created order. He was with the wild beasts. Kind of shades of Daniel in the lion's den, right? But in the case of Daniel, it says that he was safe in the lion's den because God sent an angel to shut the mouths of the lions to keep them from devouring him. Jesus needed no such intervention. I believe that the very heart of the Lenten journey is with Jesus to face our own wildernesses and temptations, and to allow him to still the wild beasts that assail us. The wilderness is everywhere, and the wild beasts are manifold. I don't expect that you or I will literally be confronted by lions or tigers or bears, oh my. Though there was an article recently in the paper about a mountain lion on a local patio. And we do see coyotes now and again. The wild beasts are around us. But I believe that we face even more ferocious beasts on a daily basis. The green-eyed monster of jealousy that causes us to want what someone else has and try to undermine them to get it. The darkness of despair. If you've been there, you know how dark it can be in the valley of despair. The ruthless idol of power and of money, an idol which cares nothing for us, will show us no love at all. The murky water of vengeance, the morass of shame. Shame is a very dark, dark place. I remember talking to a woman one time who was so filled with shame, she hardly could raise her eyes. I asked her, how does this make you feel about God? Does it make you angry at God that your life is so filled with shame? She said, no. God owes me nothing. I deserve nothing. What a horrible place to be. What a ferocious beast it is to live cowering in shame. Or the quest for glory at others' expense. I'm not talking here about the Olympic Games. That's a case where we send athletes, we want them to do their very best. And in doing so, some will win and some will lose. Some will mount the platform, receive the medals, others will fall short and go home disappointed. We want them to seek glory. That's the name of the game. But what I'm talking about is the way we often live in pride, so wanting glory for ourselves, that the way we get it is by pushing others down, lest they shine more brightly than we. That also is a wild and ferocious beast, pride, destroying relationships. Or the beast of a red-hot temper that lashes out. Sadly, we've seen that again this week in Parkland, Florida, at Marjorie Stoneman Douglas High School, where in rage, a former student murdered 17 and wounded many others. You and I, thankfully, have not done that same thing, but my guess is we have lashed out in anger many times as well. Probably most often toward those closest to us, when we have felt threatened. It's a beast. Or the wild beast of unforgiven sins that weigh us down. To not receive forgiveness is to bear a huge burden. And to not forgive others is to take an equally heavy burden upon ourselves and try to walk under its weight. The list of wild beasts goes on and on. Health issues, financial issues, relational issues, and Satan is ever present to remind us of our helplessness and hopelessness. In the face of these wild beasts, be certain of this fact: Lent is not a self-help project. Lent is not a self-help project. You cannot still these beasts. People will tell you, well, just do this or that, or look a different place, or think differently, and those beasts will go away, but they will not. We cannot dispel them ourselves, but we have one who can. Lent is about the one who has the power to still the wild beasts. It is Jesus alone who has the power to do this and to restore us to the state of innocence and righteousness for which we were created. Lent is about turning to Jesus, about fastening our eyes on Him and walking with Him and letting Him have His way with us. Lent is a season to be lived on our knees in prayer. Lent is a season for being stripped of the masks that we put on to hide ourselves from God and from one another. Lent is a season for brutally honest confession. But none of this can be done, nor will we dare to do any of it, unless we trust in Jesus and in His power and in His love for us. The second lesson today ended with these words describing Jesus, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, with angels, authorities, and powers made subject to Him. With angels, authorities, and powers made subject to Him. Do you believe that? Do you believe that all things have been put under Jesus' control? He Himself said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me." All authority in heaven and on earth. Jesus has the power to still the wild beasts, to still your wild beasts and my wild beasts. Jesus has the power to quell Satan's might at every turn. So let us let Him do it in us and for us. Let Him do it in us and for us. For this is what it means to keep a holy Lent. Amen.